This week on Maker Update, a transforming bicycle, fixing benches with trash, a glowing Etch-A-Sketch, robot hands, expensive lumber, and how to use any filament. Hello and welcome back to another Maker Update. I'm Tyler Weingarner and I hope you're doing great and finding ways to stay inspired and connected in this crazy world we're all in. I've got an awesome show full of great projects, so let's start off with the project of the week. The way a bicycle feels and rides is determined by the shape of its frame, and the frame of a bicycle is usually rigid. Usually. But Colin Furze has created a bicycle where nearly every single one of its frame members is replaced with a hydraulic piston, to create a bicycle that can modify its own shape so it can create whatever sort of riding characteristics he wants. This thing is crazy. The top tube, down tube, forks, and seat stays have all been replaced with hydraulic pistons. It was easier for Colin to build a new frame from scratch than to try and modify an existing bicycle frame, and you get to see the entire process in a comical build montage. You also get to see all of Colin's bike modification expertise at play here, including all the custom tools he's built to cut angular holes in tube frames. The hydraulics are actuated by a single electric motor that drives the pump. The hydraulic fluid is directed through a valved manifold, so you can direct the pressure where you want it to go. Open the valve for the forks, and the forks get longer. With all of the tubing for the hydraulics, the bike certainly has a look, and kind of a cool one. As to how it rides, it sounds like it leaves a lot to be desired. The bike is very heavy, tipping the scales at over 100 pounds. Plus, hydraulic pistons aren't as rigid as steel tubes, so it does wobble around quite a bit. But I don't think you'll find a bike that's a better learning tool for how frame geometry affects how a bike rides. Colin tries out a number of bizarre frame styles and rides all of them. It's a fun video. Go check it out.
No, that doesn't work.
Woodworker, guitar maker, and all-around good guy Tim Sway has just announced two new tools that he's planning on manufacturing, and they're presently in the prototyping phase, the Square X and the Square L. These are both measuring tools that work similar to the depth gauge on a set of calipers, but are made to be a little bit easier to use. Because the reference surface is larger, it's easier to get a good read of the depth you're trying to measure. The Square X has an additional slide ruler perpendicular to the first, opening up more measuring options. If these sound useful to you, you can learn more about their production by following the links down in the description. More projects. Sam from Look Mum No Computer hacked this old XY plotter into a glow-in-the-dark Etch-A-Sketch. Sam got really obsessed with plotters after visiting the Mono Art Studio in Berlin, and who could blame him? His idea for this project was to make it so the plotter could be used to draw manually, but he wanted to avoid using any of the costly and hard-to-find consumables. Instead of a pen and paper, he's using photoreactive paper and an ultraviolet laser. The joystick makes it easy to do simple drawings, but things get really nuts when he hooks it up to one of his many synths to plot the music as a drawing. Cool stuff. While on a walk with her dog Smudo, Laura Comp found this broken bench along the Rhine River in her city of Cologne, and tasked herself with repairing it so folks could enjoy it again. She's been trying to not spend any money on materials for her projects, and her neighbor happened to have just the perfect material for municipal upcycling, pallet wood. The bench seats themselves are gorgeous, but I love the expression here. Finding something broken in your community, and instead of asking for permission to make it better, just doing it. We could all use a little bit more of that energy in our lives right now. And we have to talk about the incredible engineering being done by Ian Davis in his mission to build his own ideal prosthetic hand. You've probably seen some of his videos being kicked around social media with this impressive mechanical hand. It's all made of machined aluminum, and it's beautiful to behold. Both the grasping motion and finger splay are driven mechanically, and he is currently working on a system that will use micro-stepper motors to lock the fingers. The steppers will be driven by an Arduino that responds to myoelectric sensors. Along the way, he's taken the time to have fun with the possibilities of having a replaceable hand. And over on the Adafruit blog, I found this 5th Element style multi-pass holder for your CDC vaccination card. Hopefully you're able to get into a vaccination appointment and you're able to fill out that card. If you're looking for a stylish way to show it off as we figure out how to re-socialize again, check out this 3D printable multi-pass holder from Level 2-3. This is a three-part print, perfect for helping you gain access to restaurants, museums, and whatever else you want to get into in your post-COVID life. Now for some tips and tools. Zach Friedman has a new video out, and it's a helpful guide on how to use just about any 3D printer filament. I've been reluctantly making the transition out of my comfy happy place of printing everything in PLA to using PETG. If you're still in that happy place, you'll be well served. Zach spends about the first third of the video just talking about the different variants of PLA. It's a long video, and there's plenty to chew on here, but tons of useful advice as well. We've been talking up Tim Hunkin's YouTube series, The Secret Life of Components, an awful lot, but his recent episode about glue is a really special gem. Glues are the critical components that literally hold all of our projects together, but we probably don't understand what they do and how they work anywhere near as much as we depend on them. This video will give you a greater appreciation for how glues work and how to select the right one for the task at hand. If you've wandered around the sheet goods section of your local home center, you've found that the prices of lumber are impossible to ignore, and you've probably wondered why. Belinda Carr has this fantastic video about how both supply chain issues and a boom in house building has contributed to this financial pinch in our hobby. It won't make the price of lumber come down any faster, but at least give you a greater appreciation for why it is the way it is. In the most recent edition of Gareth Branwen's Tips, Tools, and Shop Tales newsletter, he showcases videos from Project Farm on determining what is the best tape measure you can buy, and an older video from Jeremy Fielding about how to build your projects without spending any money. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, we need to talk about DigiKey Red. DigiKey Red is the company's own PCB manufacturing service. DK Red offers two-layer PCB manufacturing at $1.50 per square inch and with a minimum manufacturing run of 4 boards per order, with a 10-day turnaround. The color selection to your boards is limited. I hope you like red. But otherwise, this seems like a fantastic offering. And that is going to do it for this week's show. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed these projects and tips as much as I enjoyed finding them. If you did, give us a thumbs up or leave us a comment. And sign up for the Maker Update email list so you don't miss a show. As always, big thanks to our friends at DigiKey for making this show possible and having all the cool parts that make our projects work. Take care out there. We'll see you soon.